What if I told you this toxic lake behind me is actually one of the most valuable pieces of real estate in North America? An accident over 100 years ago created this environmental disaster, but now a new wave of engineering could turn this exact spot into America's largest source of lithium. This is the Salton Sea, and it could single-handedly flip the United States from critical mineral importer to a global production powerhouse. Companies like Ford, GM, and Berkshire Hathaway are pouring billions of dollars into this toxic shoreline. They're calling it Lithium Valley. So how did this happen? How could something so toxic, so desolate, hold the key to our clean energy future? And as an engineer, the question that's bugging me, can we even get the lithium out without making this disaster even worse? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Adventure.
This video is brought to you by E-Range EV Tires.
The reason why everyone is here is not because of the lake. It's because of what's under it. The Salton Sea sits directly on top of the San Andreas Fault, a massive tectonic boundary. Here, the Earth's crust is being stretched thin and magma is incredibly close to the surface. You can see it right here. These are mud volcanoes. That's not steam. That's gas and mud being pushed to the surface by the immense heat and pressure just below our feet. The insane geology makes the Salton Sea one of the most productive geothermal energy fields on the planet. There are already 11 geothermal plants operating here, churning out clean, reliable, 24/7 baseload energy. The process is simple, but brutal. They drill thousands of feet down and pump up scorching hot pressurized brine. We're talking 500 to 600 degrees Fahrenheit. That heat flashes water to steam, and the steam spins a turbine. You get electricity. And the used cooler brine is just re-injected back into the ground in a closed loop system. For decades, that brine was just a heat source. The minerals in it were just a nuisance, a corrosive scaling nightmare that engineers had to manage. But as it turns out, that hot corrosive brine isn't just hot water, it's liquid rock. It's a pressurized soup of dissolved minerals. And because of this unique geology, it's loaded with lithium.
This is the heart of Lithium Valley. And when you run the numbers, you understand why this is Lithium Valley and not just lithium ditch. First, the concentration. The geothermal brine has lithium levels averaging 200 to 250 parts per million. For comparison, the seawater in the Pacific Ocean has around 0.17 parts per million. This brine then has 1,200 times the concentration of the oceans. Second, the total resource. Geologists estimate that the total lithium resources underneath the Salton Sea is a staggering 18 million metric tons of lithium carbonate equivalent, or LCE.
Now let's put those numbers in perspective. According to the latest USGS report, the entire United States has around 1.8 million tons of lithium reserves. This one spot adds 18 million tons of resources. That's crazy. Overnight, we overtook China, Australia, and even Chile in total possible reserves. Third, the production potential. And this is where it gets crazy. The 11 existing geothermal plants already pump 121 million metric tons of brine to the surface every year just to make electricity.
121 million tons of brine at 200 parts per million, that's 24,000 tons of pure lithium flowing through the pipes already today.
That 24,000 tons of lithium is enough to cover about 8% of the entire planet's current lithium demand.
All you have to do is put an extraction system in the middle and you're golden. They don't have to drill new wells. They don't have to pump a single extra gallon. They just have to filter the wastewater before they pump it back into the ground. That 24,000 tons of lithium is enough to cover about 8% of the entire planet's current lithium demand.
Just as a byproduct of the power we're already making at the Salton Sea geothermal field. So the problem is, how do we get the lithium out?
So to film this episode, we drove our EV from San Diego out to Joshua Tree National Park and the Salton Sea. That's over 300 miles of desert highway, mountain passes, and some of the most stunning terrain in California. And honestly, the tires were the last thing I wanted to worry about. That's why we run E-Range EV tires. They're specifically engineered for the unique demands of electric vehicles. And on a trip like this, you'll notice the difference. First, the range. E-Range's low rolling resistance design means you get more range per charge. We get about 15 miles more with a full charge. Second, the handling. Joshua Tree's winding mountain roads and the rough, damaged pavement around the Salton Sea put those reinforced sidewalls to the test, with crisp cornering, confident grip, even when the road surfaces were questionable. And third, the noise. E-Range's silent tread technology kept the cabin quiet, even at highway speeds. When you're driving for hours through the desert, that 3 decibel reduction is noticeable. E-Range EV tires are engineered for the extra weight of EV batteries, the instant torque, and the efficiency demands that make electric vehicles different. And they handle all that without compromise. It's why we run E-Range EV tires on both of our EVs. We've had our E-Range EV tires on our Model Y for over 2 years. We've put over 25,000 miles on them, and they're on track to last over the 50,000 miles that they're rated for, which is a huge improvement in longevity compared to the tires that we were running before. To learn more about our favorite brand of tires specifically engineered for your EV, check out the amazing lineup of E-Range EV tires today. Links in the description. Huge thanks to E-Range EV and you. Now back to the show. We did some research, and there are a few technologies to extract lithium from salty brine. The first one is evaporation ponds. This is the method that's most popular in South America's lithium triangle. It involves pumping brine into massive 1,000-acre evaporation ponds and letting the sun dry it out over 18 to 24 months. It's slow, it's inefficient, and recovering only about 50% of the lithium, and it wastes a catastrophic amount of water. And we don't have the space, the time, or the water for that.
The solution is a breakthrough technology called direct lithium extraction, or DLE. Think of it as a hyper-advanced chemical filter, but for individual atoms.
Here's how it works. The brine is fed through columns or beds filled with a special material, a sorbent. This sorbent is an engineering marvel designed at a molecular level to be sticky to only lithium ions. It's like a molecular sieve with holes perfectly shaped to catch the tiny lithium ions. While all the other stuff, the massive amounts of sodium, potassium, calcium, and all those other contaminants, just flow right through. After the sorbent is full of lithium, they flush it with a stripping solution like water or a mild acid, which releases the lithium now in a much purer and more concentrated form.
The results are staggering. These DLE processes can recover 90 to 97% of the lithium from the brine, and they do it in a matter of hours, not years. Best of all, it's a closed-loop system. The used brine, now stripped of its lithium, is piped straight back into reinjection wells and sent back underground, just like it was before. The land footprint is tiny, and it uses far less water than other lithium mining methods, and the whole process is powered by 100% clean geothermal energy from the plant it's bolted onto.
This all sounds great, but the reason this is happening now is because the economics are just unbelievable. A 2021 study of the National Renewable Energy Laboratory analyzed the DLE process being developed right here for Salton Sea brine, and their estimate is about $3,845 per ton of lithium carbonate equivalent. For comparison, traditional evaporation ponds cost between $3,000 and $6,400 per ton, and the energy-intensive hard rock mining cost between $5,000 and $8,000 per ton. So DLE right now is in line, and if not cheaper, than the existing methods.
But the operating cost isn't even the best part. The capital cost, the cost to build the factory, that's the real story.
That same NREL report estimated the total cost of building a DLE plant capable of producing 20,000 tons of LCE per year would cost only about $50.3 million. Now, a similar sized new geothermal lithium project in Germany's Rhine Valley, which also uses DLE, has a capital cost of $1.3 billion. So why is the Salton Sea project 24 times cheaper? It's because the project here are brownfield developments. The hardest part is already done. The billion-dollar geothermal plants are already built. The wells are already drilled thousands of feet into the earth. The pumps are running. The pipes are in place. The grid connection is hot. The DLE plant is just a bolt-on addition. It's a relatively small $50 million factory that you bolt onto the waste pipe of a billion-dollar facility that's already been paid for and turning a profit. The NREL report ran the numbers on this, and the result is an estimated internal rate of return of 268%.
That number is astronomical. It's like investing $50,000 to build a food truck, and in your very first year of business, after paying for all the food and the gas and your salaries, the truck generating $134,000 in pure profit. It's practically a license to print money. And that's why everyone is here.
Berkshire Hathaway Energy, that's Warren Buffett's company, owns 10 of the 11 active plants and is running its own pilot DLE demonstrator. Energy Source Minerals is building a commercial scale plant, Project Atlas, using its proprietary Iliad DLE technology. And Controlled Thermal Resources, or CTR, is building the Hell's Kitchen Project, a brand new geothermal plant and DLE facility, aiming to produce 20,000 tons of lithium per year.
It's a perfect synergy. The geothermal power makes the lithium extraction wildly profitable, and the lithium profits make building more geothermal plants an absolute no-brainer.
So then, what's the catch? It's the perfect solution, a green extraction method powered by renewable energy that secures America's battery supply chain, right?
That's the craziest part about all this, but let's hit the brakes for a second. Yes, this is a perfect technical solution, but it's being bolted onto a human and environmental disaster. To understand what's at stake, you need to know what this place is. This lake, California's largest, shouldn't even be here.
It's a terminal basin sitting in one of the lowest, driest, and hottest places in North America, over 200 feet below sea level. Its creation was a catastrophic engineering failure.
This is the Alamo River, the modern descendant of the canal that broke in 1905. Over 120 years ago, engineers were trying to divert water from the Colorado River to irrigate the Imperial Valley, but the Colorado River flooded and breached the canal's defenses, and they couldn't stop it.
For two solid years, the entire flow of the Colorado River poured into this desert basin. By the time they finally sealed the breach in 1907, it had created a 400-square-mile lake, the Salton Sea. For a while, people thought it would just evaporate, but it didn't. In fact, with all the agricultural runoff from the booming Imperial and Coachella valleys constantly feeding it, the lake was stable. So in the 1950s and 60s, they turned it into a resort.
It's hard to imagine now with the state of how it is, but Bombay Beach Resort, this used to be like a bustling, idyllic place to spend summers.
People built towns, vacation homes. It was like a paradise. But that paradise was built on a lie. And as an engineer, you know that systems without outputs are a recipe for disaster. The Salton Sea's only real water source is agricultural runoff. And that runoff is carrying two things, salt and fertilizer. First, the salts. An estimated 4 million tons of dissolved salts flow into the lake every single year. Since the water evaporates but the salt doesn't, the lake gets saltier with every passing year. Today, the Salton Sea is twice as salty as the Pacific Ocean. Second, the fertilizers. For over a century, all the excess nitrates and phosphates from one of the America's most productive farming regions have ended up right here. The phosphorus load alone doubled between 1965 and the 2000s. For the algae in the lake, this is an all-you-can-eat buffet. This massive nutrient load triggers eutrophication, a fancy word for colossal algae blooms. And that is what causes the smell. When all that algae dies, it sinks. Bacteria at the bottom feast on the dead algae, multiplying like crazy and consuming all the dissolved oxygen in the water. No oxygen means everything else dies. Massive fish die-offs became routine. The resort towns dried out, leaving behind these post-apocalyptic ghost towns that you see today. And it's only getting worse. In the last 20 years, water conservation efforts have cut the amount of runoff flowing into the lake, so the lake is shrinking fast. And this has exposed thousands of acres of dry lake bed called playa.
This is absolutely insane. There's like art installations. Honestly, this reminds me of Burning Man. Maybe we should start our own California version, call it Drowning Man, and it'll be based right here on the Salton Sea.
And this isn't just any dust. This is a toxic powder made up of dried salt, pesticides, and 100 years of concentrated fertilizer. And when the winds pick up, it creates a public health catastrophe. The air here is so bad that childhood asthma and respiratory illness rates are among the highest in the state. So that's the reality on the ground, which brings us back to the original question. We have the perfect technical solution, a wildly profitable, clean energy powered lithium machine. And we have a massive human problem, a toxic shrinking lake that is poisoning the air for the disadvantaged communities that live here. So can the engineering solution for the lithium also be the solution for the lake? This green extractivism doesn't inherently fix the Salton Sea. In fact, it adds another layer of heavy industry and another major demand on fresh water for one of the driest places on Earth.
But what if we could do both? What if we think bigger? The core problem is a lack of water. And you can't take any more from the Colorado River. But the Salton Sea is 200 feet below sea level. And the Pacific Ocean is 75 miles away. What if we built a pipeline or a tunnel from the ocean? Water would flow downhill by itself, no pumping required, And this isn't just one of my crazy ideas. It's been seriously proposed. And it could refill the lake, it could cover the toxic playa, and stop dust storms, and slowly restore the habitat. And here's the two-bit idea. Something like that could actually solve the industrial challenges.
First, you could install a hydroelectric turbine at the end of the 200-foot drop and generate even more clean power. Second, the geothermal plants could use the abundant incoming seawater for their cooling towers instead of precious freshwater. And third, you could even use the heat from the geothermal brine to desalinate the seawater, creating a new drought-proof source of freshwater for the DLE process and the communities at large.
Imagine it, a single, massive integrated system, geothermal plants making clean power, DLE systems filtering the brine of America's lithium supply, an ocean pipeline refilling the lake, stopping the toxic dust, restoring the ecosystem, and generating more power on its way in. This is a rare opportunity to use brilliant large-scale engineering to fix a century-old environmental disaster by creating the very material we need for a clean energy transition. This is an absolutely wild place, and I highly recommend if you have a chance to come check it out for yourself. I'm sinking with every step. The smells are not what I expected, actually. Everyone kept telling me it'll smell sulfur, rotten eggs, but that isn't what I'm getting at all. That, to me, sounds like toxic and wasteland. This, I smell birds and like dead fish and bird poop and like living things, like decomposing things. Completely not what I expected. There's even ducks out there on the horizon, but just looking at this water, you can tell something's not right. There's something going on. The weird tranquility that you feel when you come to this place comes from two things. One, there's no waves because it's not open ocean. And also the higher density, the higher viscosity from all those materials and salts makes it just kind of slowly roll over as the winds hit it. But there's no waves. It's an incredibly still body of water. Staggering stuff. But we have to remember that this is a ecological disaster in progress, and it does also represent a massive boom in terms of lithium. But what do you think? I'm always optimistic, and I think this could potentially have a chance for us to get the materials that we need and clean up our act. But let me know what you think. Do we have a shot of actually getting this right for once? Sound off in the comments below. And until next week, check out this video I think you're gonna like. I'm Ricky with Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.